Well, most of us love the freedom to travel where we desire, but there is a different set of rules if you're traveling as a person of color, and more so if you're a Black woman. Travel expert Natalie Preddie is back along with travel educator Margie Jordan. Thank you so much, both of you, for joining us. Margie, I'm going to start with you because you wrote an article for Travel Weekly on this very topic, and you talk about some of the places where you were definitely aware that you were being treated differently as a Black woman. Can you tell us about a couple of those experiences?
Absolutely. I think the most experience was traveling in the Caribbean. I often find that when I am in luxury properties in particular, that other guests, particularly white guests, think I am the help, that I'm part of the staff, the housekeeper, or someone that can grab a taxi for them. So I've been stopped in halls, in lobbies, and asked to do all sorts of things that someone on the staff would do.
We can definitely relate to that. People still ask my husband if he's the gardener when he's out front of our house. So I understand that situation. Natalie, what about your experience? You say that you definitely have a fear of white countries. What do you mean by that?
Looking at countries that have a big population, I think that that probably comes from my experience growing up, and if we ever traveled to the U.S., you know, that's where we were refused service in a restaurant, that's where we get racist comments, that's where we've been, you know, have had people shake their heads at us, and I've really avoided countries that tend to have a large white population for that reason. I backpacked Southeast Asia, for instance, by myself for a year. I think I met one or two Black people over the whole year. And with the big language barrier there, especially when I got to borders, people would say, "What are you? Where are you from?" "Oh, I'm Canadian." "No, but what are you?" White guys would say, "Oh, you know, so you're half Black." "Well, that's crazy because I've never been attracted to a Black girl before," and which is infuriating. I don't even know what that means.
So a couple of interesting things you said, Natalie. One of the countries that you said you would be kind of hesitant to visit, you've got South Africa on that list. And why is that sort of a scary place for you?
Well, you know, apartheid is in my lifetime. And as a biracial woman who often travels on her own, I just didn't feel comfortable there, you know, being, you know, both Black and white. I still struggle at times to figure out where I fit in here in North America, and with such race struggles over there, and I'm very aware of that. It just wasn't somewhere that I felt comfortable and safe, as you said, going on my own.
So this is interesting because Margie has been to South Africa, and Margie, when you got there, you were asked at the hotel to identify your nationality, and you put Black because that's what we think when we're in North America. We are identified as Black, and you looked around you and everyone was Black. So what did you change your answer to?
Well, I changed my answer to American, and, you know, it was a difficult moment for me because it's the first time ever in my life I was able to just be an American. I wasn't Black. I didn't have to be identified by my skin color. In fact, nobody cared. I was American for the first time in my life. It was one of the defining moments for me being in Africa, just to be able to travel and actually be an American.
Now, you say that has actually sort of skewed you towards traveling in countries where the majority of the people are brown-skinned, because there's a feeling of comfort there. Is that true?
Very true. I have looked back over the years of my travel experiences and where I've had the best ones. And yeah, I've pretty much stayed in countries where people are more brown skinned than anything, even olive tone skin. Although I will admit I have a massive love affair with Italy. So primarily I've traveled to countries where I don't feel that I'm different. I don't stand out. Nobody's looking at me any differently because my skin is brown, my hair is curly. Nobody cares. That's where I have the best travel experiences and where I have the least amount of frustrations and racism at all is in countries where there are more brown-skinned people.
So you mentioned that, you know, the Negro Motorist Green Book is the thing that was used in the past for blacks in America to know where they could actually safely travel. Right now, what we do is we just have an inner circle where we talk to each other or we talk to people who know the region and ask them about what's happening in terms of racism and discrimination. What we do as a family is my husband always makes sure that whenever we rent an Airbnb or a cottage, he puts his picture on the profile. He says, we are a black family because we don't want any surprises when we actually get there. But the worst time we ever had was actually in Dominican Republic, where his complexion marked him as a Haitian and he was treated horribly. And my complexion made me, they felt I was one of them and I was treated way better. It was incredibly odd. Tell me about your most welcome travel experience, Natalie. So we know with Margie, it's about Italy. With Natalie, what is it for you?
I moved to England in 2004, and I think that was the first time that I realized there were people who looked like me, and there were a lot of people who looked like me. And I was beautiful. I'd never seen so many black neighborhoods where I felt welcome, and you know, I wasn't an anomaly. And I still love London for that reason. And it will always have this very special place in my heart just because I felt like I was welcomed there. And I stayed till 2012.
Well, I commend Margie and Natalie. Thank you so much for your travel education.